Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our sixth live session by Outdoor Wilderness and Learning, Owl in Short. Every week, we organize a one-on-one talk with eminent personalities who share their perspective on business and life and try to make sense of a world where COVID-19 will be a reality for a while longer. 4 months into the pandemic, and we have all seen its immense destructive powers. Life and business is not the same as we once knew it. No business organization has ever prepared for such a scenario of total disruption, except one, the defense services. Not only do they prepare and train for disruption throughout their career, they practically thrive in it. We look at the military as an organization that responds robustly to crisis and comes out with an efficient response irrespective of the challenges faced. Whether it is serving in the icy heights of Siachen, combating enemies on the border, or dealing with natural calamities, there is a sense of composure and purpose in how the military goes about its work. So what lessons can we draw from the way they train and work? Today's topic is handling disruptive change, lessons from the military. It is my honor and privilege to introduce our next speaker, Lieutenant General Dipendra Singh Hooda. Lieutenant General Hooda is a veteran of the Indian Army with 40 years of service in uniform. During his career, he has held leadership positions in conducting counter-terror operations in Jammu and Kashmir and Manipur and handling the volatile borders with Pakistan and China. As the Army Commander of Northern Command, he is well known for his role in the planning and execution of the cross-border surgical strike into Pakistan in September 2016. So let me welcome General Hooda on today's one-on-one session with us. Good morning, General Hooda. How are you today?
Thank you, Abhi. Thank you for having me on your show.
Our pleasure.
You know, just like everybody else is, I think, looking at, you know, what the future is going to be, I think similarly, you know, we are all in the same boat. So I'm glad I have this opportunity to speak a little today, you know, about life in the military and how we handle these issues.
Absolutely. Because General Hooda, this pandemic has thrown life and business completely out of gear. This may be a new normal for us, but a crisis like this may have been the regular normal for you throughout your career.
So for us, as we say, disruptive change or change is something that we are quite used to. You know, our movements from peace stations to border areas, the challenges that you face, and it just does appear that, you know, every day is a new solution and a new situation. There are many, you know, lessons that I think we can talk about today, particularly in the area of handling change. Yeah,
absolutely. And in fact, we are really looking forward to the session with you. And here's a request to the audience. General Hooda's talk will be followed by a Q&A round. So please feel free to send your questions on YouTube. So, General, over to you.
So thank you, Abhik. As you mentioned, you know, we are in really unprecedented times. We just are very, very uncertain about how the future will unfold and what we can do. In the military, as you mentioned, we are used to handling uncertainties, crises, situations, disruptive change, as they call it. And so I will talk a little about most of my lessons and incidents that I'm going to talk about are obviously drawn from military life. But I think there could be some relevance that your viewers could find in those lessons. I'm going to broadly talk about three areas of how, you know, we can handle disruptive change. And the first area is the role of the organizational ethic and how that can help support the organization. The second is about building a culture of collaboration and trust in organizations. And finally, I will talk about a few leadership lessons from handling a crisis. So I have a small presentation, Abhik, and I will just start with that.
Absolutely, General.
Okay, so as I said, the first area I'm going to talk about is the organizational ethic. As you mentioned, Abhik, it seems almost normal for us to, you know, to be able to handle changes which are disruptive, both to individuals and to organizations. And let me try and put this in context to you by showing you some of the areas that we serve in. So this is the Cargill sector, Abhik. And what you see is a post in the Cargill sector. These are areas literally, as they say, on you know, knife edge, razor shape, mountain tops. In these small posts, you have 10 to 15 men. Getting to these posts is sometimes you know, the biggest challenge. You literally have to do, as they say, rock climbing to be able to get to these posts. And frankly, the conditions there are very, very basic, because trying to transport, you know, any kind of good facilities is also almost impossible. So this is how people stay. Maybe, you know, one living shelter and, you know, a few bunkers for fighting with the enemy. What happens a week in these areas is that in the month of November, a soldier, you know, will hitch on a backpack with his stuff. And walk up to these posts. In a few weeks, the snow will come, and then he will come down from here only when the snow melts in the month of May. For 6 months, you know, there are 10, 12 soldiers just living together. Obviously, there is no mobile connectivity. There is no internet. Speaking home, you know, over army lines. Maybe once a week, once in 10 days is when you can actually get to speak. And so living in these isolated conditions by themselves becomes for us how to motivate soldiers in these conditions. And even more difficult than this, of course, you've all heard of Siachen. I'll show you some photographs of Siachen. This is the highest military deployment in the world, more than 21,000 feet. And again, you have not more than 8 to 10 soldiers living in these areas. Siachen is extremely, extremely difficult because of heights and because of the fact that there are no roads. Transporting any kind of shelters for living becomes extremely difficult. So most people actually live in tents like this, as you are seeing. But I think what is not well known also to too many people is that there are areas where you can't even transport tents. And therefore, you have soldiers, you know, who dig into the snow, and you dig and you dig. And these are the conditions in which people live. And they live like this not for a few days. I mean, it's not an adventure camp. So Siachen tenures typically vary between 6 months in some areas to 2 years. People live in these conditions. It's a complete disruption from life as you think normally. You know, a month ago, these soldiers could have been sitting at Delhi, Bombay, Ahmedabad, or some city with their families, enjoying the same kind of facilities and privileges that that we have. And suddenly, they are transported to this kind of life. And it's not as if you're just sitting inside your shelter. Irrespective of the conditions, irrespective of whether there is snow, rain, hail, you have to patrol the border. You have to do your duty. Managing the border, making sure there is no infiltration happening. So this typically, these are the kind of patrols that go out. Waist deep snow, sometimes chest deep snow. But go out, they will. Work, they will. What keeps them going, Abhik, in these kind of conditions? And as I said, the first thing is the organizational ethic. Let me give you a quote from General John Hackett. And he said, the whole pattern of life of the professional man is designed to foster qualities like courage, fortitude, loyalty, not because they are morally desirable, but because they are functionally indispensable. And I think this is key. So we talk about, yes, soldiers have great values, military has great values. These values are fostered, these values are reinforced, not because they sound good. These values are reinforced because without them, the military will collapse. And it is these qualities and the feeling they gave that the mission is more important than the individual himself. The objectives for which the organization is working, for which the organization is functioning, that objective means much more than your own comfort. And that sense, sort of drives performance, which to us, you know, at times seems completely extraordinary. And so my small advice to organizations is that you must inculcate a set of values that must be fostered. It's pointless, you know, saying these are my company values and then putting them, on the board, on your wall and saying, see, this is what it is. Unless they are fostered, unless they are practiced, unless they are inculcated in the organization, it's of little value. And so it's this organizational ethic of the military, which actually helps us bond together during times of difficulty, during times of crisis. As I said earlier, the feeling that we are doing a task, protecting the nation, protecting our borders, which has a higher nobility than just your own personal self. And that is one thing that helps people get through crisis. That's one thing that helps you to get through disruption and difficult times. The next thing, Avig, is collaboration and trust. Now, collaboration is of extreme importance, and I'm going to explain this to you, with the help of what happened during the surgical strike or how we actually trained and managed for it. Typically, you would, when you look at movies and you look at how the surgical strike is planned and executed in movies, so you'll have one hero, the guy who does everything. In real life, it doesn't work like that. So typically, a special forces team and a team that went in for say attack on one target, and we had multiple targets, comprises three groups. So one is the snipers, as you are seeing on the photograph here. These are expert marksmen. At night, they can pick off people from 1,000 meters away. They are the people who are keeping an overwatch over the target area. So when your actual assault team is going in, these are people who are located at a distance. Extremely important. They see what's happening all around. If any threat develops from some side, because people on ground cannot see it, these are the guys who pick them off. Then, of course, the Vicky Kaushals, as I call them. The assault teams, the guys who go in and rush, the most visible guys who will go in and, attack the target, take out the terrorists. So this is known as the assault team. Then are the invisible guys, Abhik. So these are people, you can see, two-man, three-man groups who can literally make themselves invisible. So these are surveillance teams who typically are sent into the enemy area prior to the operation. And these are guys who will go in and who will carry out complete surveillance, who will be able to tell you what's the layout in the camp, how are soldiers in the enemy camp behaving, what are their patterns, what is their routine, what time do they get up, which are the sentry posts they're manning. They can stay hidden across into enemy territory for up to 72 hours without moving. And for these 72 hours, I don't want to openly say, they do everything that they have to and wherever they are. These are the most expert guys, the most highly trained. But as I said, they have very little visibility. Now, 3 days prior to the actual surgical strikes going in, we had some information that maybe at one of the target areas, more Pakistani soldiers have come in, more terrorists have come in. And so these were the people we sent in to get final confirmation. And Abhik, these are the photographs they brought back to us. I'm just showing two of them. They were literally sitting on top of the terrorist camp for 24 hours, scanning, taking photographs, telling us what exactly is going on. And it's based on the information of these people that we could make a good plan. So I've talked about three groups, and unless all three sort of collaborate and work with each other, you will not get success. And then behind the scenes, after the surgical strikes were going in, behind the scenes were others, helicopter pilots ready to go in case, some rescues required, infantry soldiers who were manning the line of control, and again, ready to go inside in an attempt in case one or team got stuck, that they would go in and rescue these guys, the artillery gunners who were ready to provide fire support. So it was a whole, while we look at, the visible guys who actually go in and do the attack and do the assault, there's a whole range and group of people who are working and collaborating together to be able to do all these things. And so the system of collaboration, and without the system of collaboration, it becomes almost impossible for us to carry out an operation. And in my talks, I always talk about this as to why, collaboration is a better strategy. There are some organizations, which encourage a culture of competitiveness in their organization. The problem with competitiveness is, Abhik, you will always have a winner and you'll always have a loser. And in organizations like the military, we always said in war, there are no runners up. Either everyone wins together or everyone loses together. If you have a culture of competitiveness, and some people do say that, it encourages everyone to give off their best. But remember, what Gore Vidal said. He said, it's just not enough to win. Someone has to lose. And so in a culture of competitiveness, you will always have winners and losers. And particularly in times of crisis, in times that we are seeing today, I think people need to depend on each other. People need to look at each other and find support and try and work together so that, everybody appears to be winning rather than some winners and some losers. And the other point I want to make is about trust. If you want to build cohesive teams in your organization, trust is absolutely, absolutely essential. And this is, again, one element of military life that actually brings in a great amount of efficiency in the military organization. So just one small story I want to tell you, Abhik. It was 2015, in the forests of North Kashmir, there was a special forces team which was going. They had some information about terrorists, a group of terrorists who was hiding in the forest. And so they were going for an operation. Unfortunately, the terrorists got wind of it. They came to know that here the special forces team is coming, and they laid an ambush. And the special forces team walked into that ambush. In the initial burst of firing, two soldiers who were right in front got very seriously injured. And behind these soldiers was Lance Nayak Goswami and Subedar Mahinder. Both of them immediately rushed in to save their comrades. And the two men who were in front, they managed to pull them out safely. They both survived. Unfortunately, Lance Nayak Goswami, got killed in the operation. He was martyred. He was awarded the Ashok Chakra, which is the highest award that can be given, and that's his wife, receiving the award from the president. The other photograph is of Subedar Mahinder, and he's again receiving a Kirti Chakra, and you find him sitting on a wheelchair. And the reason he's sitting on the wheelchair a week is because he got a bullet in the back and he was paralyzed, waist downwards. Now the question comes, we often tell ourselves that what the army does and what the soldiers do is always following orders. But when Goswami and Mahinder rushed in, to save their comrades, they were not given any orders. I mean, they went in almost immediately and rushed in to save these guys. And the reason was a big trust, because they knew that these soldiers who were wounded and lying on the ground trust their comrades to come and save them. And Goswami and Mahinder knew that if something happens to them, they trust their comrades to do exactly the same thing for them. So I think if we can inculcate this feeling of trust on each other, confidence on each other, that helps you get through some very difficult times. Somebody has my back. If I'm in trouble, somebody is going to come to my rescue. And I know there is family support at times like this, but what's more important is if the organizational support and the organizational trust among members can be inculcated, I think it would help us get through these difficult times. And my final sort of topic in the talk is leadership during crisis. How should leaders behave in times like this? Because ultimately, everybody is looking at the leader to help them get through these times. And I'll explain this again from my own life example, and a time where I think I found myself under some kind of pressure during a crisis. And this was September 2005, a week. I was posted as a brigade commander at Uri. Uri is the same place, which got famous later, but I was there posted in the same garrison in 2005. And we were responsible for manning the line of control and the border post. And we had a small garrison at Uri. 8 September 2005, around 9 o'clock a week, I was sitting in my room doing some work on the computer and just about to leave for the office. And suddenly one soldier came, rushed in, literally grabbed me by the collar and dragged me out of the room. And I was wondering, I said, what's wrong with this guy? He is getting court-martialed today, manhandling the brigade commander like this. But when he pulled me out and we were standing on the small lawn outside my room, Abhik, it was as if the world was crashing down. It was the biggest earthquake of recent times that hit us in Uri. And when I looked around and walked around the garrison, these were the kind of scenes I saw. We had something like 165 buildings, out of which 160 collapsed. And that included our stores, our living accommodation, hospitals, even on the border, at the line of control, posts were completely shattered, bunkers, living accommodation. I mean, it was like nothing was left standing. This is the scene when we saw just outside the garrison, the Uri market was in flames. Roads were completely cut off. I mean, landslides had cut Uri from the outside world. Communications were completely down. Landlines had snapped, mobile towers, very few were available that time, but they had all gone down. it was as if you were just sort of by yourself, hundreds and thousands of injured people started rushing into the military garrison, even from the civil areas, saying, "You are the ones who can save us." We had hundreds of people trapped under collapsed buildings. And then you are the senior most, and everyone's looking at you. Tell us what to do. And I think it was, for me, particularly at that time, extremely, extremely difficult time, you know, to sort of handle yourself. Because if somebody sees panic on your face, Abhik, as a leader, let me tell you that panic is so contagious. As they say, panic and fear is contagious. It will spread quickly amongst everybody. And therefore, you have to put up a brave front. I learned three things from that crisis week, and I will talk about these three things. The first is a quick decision making. There are hundreds of things that you are faced with. People are wanting you to make and give orders and give instructions and make decisions. Sometimes they are morally conflicting. For example, your earth moving equipment like dozers, do you use it to dig people out, you know, who could be survivors, or do you use it to open up the roads? Opening the roads means, you know, it's a bigger community that you are supporting and helping, because that will bring in relief material. But it's a moral dilemma. After 2 days, 3 days, do you continue to dig for survivors, knowing that, you know, maybe there are just two or three, or do you divert your equipment? So hundreds of dilemmas, you know, like this, face you almost every day in a crisis. There is no decision in a crisis that is universally good. It's going to be good for somebody. It's going to be bad for somebody. Unfortunately, that's the reality. But I think the key is to make quick decisions. It may not always be right, but it gets people galvanized. It gets people doing something. If you procrastinate and you freeze, let me tell you, getting out of that freeze is extremely, extremely difficult. If you start putting off decision-making and saying, yeah, this seems a very difficult decision to make, and therefore let me not take it now, or let me analyze the situation further and see, maybe after 2 days, I'll be able to take a much more wiser decision. A week in a crisis, I think that doesn't help at all. Lethargy will set in. And as I said, getting rid of that lethargy is extremely difficult. So for leaders, take a decision, stand by it. If you made a poor decision, it was your decision. You should be ready to accept the consequences for it. But I think don't delay it and take it quickly. The second suggestion for leaders is you resolve this dilemma of involvement versus detachment. And let me try and explain this, Abhik. What happens when you're faced with a sudden, you know, calamity and a sudden crisis is that leaders want to micromanage and involve themselves in everything. You know, we'll get our hands dirty. We will go down right to the bottom. We'll get involved in each and everything, in supervising and doing everything. That shows our leadership skill, that here we are with you, you know, pitching into everything. The problem, Abhik, with this was that you just found yourself overswamped. If you want to do everything yourself, you know, you want to oversee every rescue attempt and relief operations, the rehabilitation, what is happening, I think you will just find yourself completely, completely overworked. That's one part. And the second thing that will happen is you will ignore the long term. And that's why I'm talking about involvement versus detachment. Should you detach yourself from what you're seeing as a day-to-day thing and start looking ahead and seeing what will happen in the future. So as a leader, is that a better role for you? Or is a better role getting involved in each and everything and saying, I'm the boss and I'm the one who's going to be able to handle this crisis best. So here, I think you need to delegate to people. You need to be able to trust their initiative, encourage them. Don't stifle initiative. And at some stage as a leader, please step back. Please look at the big picture ahead. If we were only completely involved with the daily, dead, injured, handling of that, then as a leader, I wouldn't have looked ahead and seen what's going to come 3 months down the line and how do we need to prepare for that. And that's my sort of final point is of declaring victory. When and how do you declare victory? In times of crisis, it's easy to clutch at some small straws. It's easy to look at small, successes and try and make them larger than life. I know this is a natural human tendency to say, hey, after this very difficult times, yeah, they're, the green shoots of success, as people say. That's important. But I think as leaders, you should also, be able to judge as to when will success actually come. What is going to define success for us? When will it come? Because if you get satisfied with small things that are happening, again, as I said, you probably will forget the big picture. After 2 weeks of the earthquake, we had completely managed the rescue and relief efforts. Injured people were all, had all been evacuated. Roads had been opened, communications had been restored, relief had started coming in. And we could have said, wow, we've got over this crisis. But Abhik, the real work started then. And the real work was reconstruction. We had crashed posts at the border. We were 2 months away from the first snowfall. If we didn't start reconstructing, if we had started celebrating that we've done all well and didn't focus on the much more difficult task of reconstructing our posts forward, and that, in fact, was the long-term bigger challenge, because local labor was not available. Everybody was building his own house or, worried about his own thing. We had no porters to be able to transport our stores up to our post. We relied a lot on local ponies to transport our rations, etc. Local ponies, had been killed in the earthquake. So the bigger challenge was the long-term success. We often say, Abhik, in the military, that we need to distinguish between battles and wars. So you could win battles, but lose the war. And similarly, you could lose some battles, but at the end, still end up winning the war. And so the point I'm making about when to declare victory, don't be satisfied with small successes, look long term. And I want to give you a small example in this. 1975, the Americans pulled out of Vietnam after fighting a war for 20 years. They fought a massive war for 20 years. They lost almost 50,000 soldiers in that battle. But despite that, they were forced to pull out against a country like Vietnam. And they flew out from the country. Later that year, one American colonel called Colonel Summers at Hanoi met with a Vietnamese colonel whose name was Colonel Tu. So they were having a chat and Colonel Summers tells Colonel Tu, he said, you never defeated us in any battle. And Colonel Tu told him, you are right, that may be so. But he said it's also irrelevant. So you might win the battles but lose the war. And so be careful about when and how victory is declared. Don't prematurely do it. Think long-term focus. So keep, as leaders, keep the higher aim in mind, and then declare success. And I finally want to end up, Abhik, with this one slide by Lord Moran. He's he wrote this very classic book called The Anatomy of Courage after World War I, studying the soldiers. And he said, can it be said that we are defeated by our own thoughts? Are we not most fearful often when there is no danger? And I know we are in difficult times with this pandemic. Should we overplay it sometimes is something that, you know, that we need to ask ourselves. Are we getting more fearful about it than we should be? Yes, there are difficult times. Yes, there are challenging times. But I think if we have the capacity, the courage, the willpower to be able to get through it, I think we will. So Abhik, with this, I will end my slideshow. And I now hand over the stage to you.
That was a fantastic session, General Huda. And it was, in a way, I mean, I was writing some notes from here, but some of the examples that you gave from Siachen, then you spoke about the difficult conditions in which some of these soldiers are staying. And it beats me, how do they stay there for 6 months, 2 years in these kind of conditions? It cannot happen without trust and collaboration. Then you also spoke about the fantastic example in the second thing about Lance Nai Goswami and Subedar Mahendra Singh. An incredible amount of trust that went in there. You spoke about the leadership in crisis and some of the things that, again, if I could recap, it is quick decision making. I think that's the need of the hour right now. Involvement versus detachment. That's the other thing that you spoke about. And of course, declaring victory, focus on the big picture and distinguish between battles and wars. So I think those are some of the takeaways, but this is a presentation that we need to come back and watch again and again, because there is so much in gems of wisdom in this particular talk. And of course, as we do with every session, General, we have a Q&A round from our audience. So now with your permission, I would like to take the first question over here. So one of them is, what's the difference between, you've spoken about the special forces, and we don't hear many stories about them in their missions, because most of it is shrouded in secrecy. The only ones in the public domain are the Myanmar strikes, because some channels have documented them. And of course, a surgical strike, the one on Pakistan, and you were so closely involved in the entire planning of that mission. And of course, then there was this Vicky Kaushal movie that was made on that. So that's why these are two in the public domain. But we do hear about their immense mental strength. Of course, they are fantastic in what they do, etc. But I believe that it's their mental makeup that distinguishes them from the rest of the soldiers. So what are these guys really made of that make them so superhuman, so to say?
So Abhik, you raised a good point. Special forces in the Indian Army, I think, are as good as any in the world. Outstanding training, high levels of motivation. What is their mental makeup? So what happens is, firstly, there is a very rigorous selection process. So people come, they volunteer, and they're put through training. A majority of them actually do not get through or successfully their training. So you're picking a handful of guys who are physically and mentally, as it is, extremely, extremely tough. The second thing is, the rigor of training, Abhik, the kind of training that they're put through, the physical and mental challenges, that actually makes you a much, much better man. You know, you feel for yourself that if I can do all of this, then there is nothing that I cannot do. I have gone through these kind of rigors. So it's the training and preparations, you know, that they are put through that gives them an immense amount of confidence. And the third thing, as I said, you know, is the organizational culture. You know, I belong to special forces. This is special. I cannot let it down. I think that drives a lot. You know, this pride in the organization, I keep saying this, and I've said this in my talk also. This pride in the organization is a great, great strength for people. That I belong to this organization, and there is no way that I'll do something that will put it in poor light. And of course, the leadership is outstanding. The young officers, the commanding officers, the junior leaders, the JSOs, they themselves, you know, set fantastic examples. I give you that example of Subedar Mahinder. I mean, a very senior guy, but I mean, he didn't hesitate himself to rush in to save his comrade. So I think these are things that make the special forces special.
So here's another one, that despite all of this, we have seen that people from the defense forces leading normal lives. How do you handle the pressure of crisis throughout your lives and still remain grounded?
I think because, it becomes...
Yeah.
So Abhik, I think it becomes second nature that, you know, you're going to be pitched into situations like this. After some time, in fact, some people feel uncomfortable, you know, yeah, the situation is too peaceful. You know, nothing is happening. Everything seems to be too normal. So it's something that you get used to. I mean, in my 40 years of service, Abhik, I would have probably seen more than 20 different locations and stations and moving from one place to another. So I think this change in some ways becomes sort of routine to us. And then you... Honestly, I think the group of people around you, the motivation, the trust, the confidence, that, as I said, helps you get through many, many difficult situations.
So General, here's the thing. A lot of people have been, as we know, their lives have been disrupted, but for some, they've lost their jobs, businesses are suffering. So they're really at their wits' end. And, you know, we've heard of this case of Sushant Rajput as well. And, you know, it's just the mental makeup of a lot of people. While some companies are doing well, but a lot of it, they're really undergoing a lot of pain here. What is that one piece of advice that you would give them? One, I mean, you've given several, but right now, especially for these people who are really suffering at the end of their tether, so to say, what is that one piece of advice you would give them as a leader to just get them into an action mode? What is that one thing they should do at this time?
So Abhik, you know, frankly, we can't downplay the problems that are happening. As you're saying, I am also hearing stories about people losing their jobs, losing their livelihood. And these are extremely, extremely difficult times. And to say that, you know, there is something you can say by words which is going to reduce, you know, the problems, I think is not there. My advice only is, and that is something that I used to ask myself, you know, when you felt completely down and out, was, is this the worst that can happen to you? And if not, there is a way that you can pick yourself up. And move ahead. I mean, yes, things are bad. Yes, but it isn't as if you know, this is the worst thing that could ever happen to you in life. So I think look at it from that perspective. Remain a little positive. As I said, if you know, the support structures must exist for these people. I know companies will say we have to fire people. But somewhere I think, you know, that empathy, the organizational support, and the support from your own, you know, comrades and families is something I think that will help help us get through these times. But Abhik, these are difficult times, and I know to say this to somebody who's lost his job or sitting at home, you know, may not sound adequate.
Yes. With that, General Huda, we come to the end of this session. It was an absolute delight listening to you today, and thank you so much for gracing our chat show on outdoor wilderness and learning. So we wish you great health and hope to see you soon again in the near future on another chat of ours, because these stories, we are not letting you go, because these are kind of stories that, you know, you want to hear again and again. And thank you once again, General Huda, for being on our show.
My pleasure, Abhik. It was wonderful interacting with you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was Lieutenant General Dipendra Singh Huda. And thank you for watching today's session that was brought to you by OWL. So stay tuned for more such meaningful sessions with thought leaders that we will bring to you from time to time. So until our next session, stay healthy, stay safe.